you, like my staff and me, came across a particular investigative report about him this week. You may not be familiar with the name Clarence Aaron. Aaron was a star linebacker at the historically black Southern University in Louisiana when he introduced one of his classmates to the brother of a cocaine dealer from his native Mobile, Alabama. So then a set of drug crimes ensued after that introduction, and those crimes landed Aaron in prison, where for almost 20 years now, he has been serving the harshest sentence of anyone involved. 3 life sentences without any chance at parole. Aaron is now a 43-year-old man. Here he is posing for pictures in 2010 with his family during a visit. And like any federal prisoner who applies, he does have a chance at presidential commutation, but it's a very slim one. President Obama has only approved 1 commutation out of nearly 3,800 requests. President Bush, 11 out of nearly 7,500 before him. But Aaron's odds are proving to be even longer than that. According to the investigative report that I mentioned earlier, the report whose writer is going to join me right now is Daphna Linsner of ProPublica. Daphna, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
So this report had us in Nerdland just appalled. Tell us why Aaron's sentence was so long in the first place.
Yeah, you know, Aaron really became kind of a symbol of the excesses of the drug war. Right. He was part of a conspiracy, and often a conspiracy, the person in the group of those arrested who kind of knows the least, who's kind of not able to plead out or cut a deal, ends up getting the harshest sentence. So here he is, not the buyer, the user, the seller, the dealer, and he gets a triple life sentence. In fact, of all the people who were involved in the conspiracy, every single person is out except for the dealer, who is scheduled to be released in 2014.
But Aaron won't be.
That's right. If he doesn't get a presidential commutation, he will die in prison, having gone in at the age of 24.
Right. And I want to be clear. He made an introduction here. Mm-hmm. When we hear, you know, drug conspiracy, you know, you're thinking of, you know, guys in the back room and some kind of, you know, big dealer sort of thing. And these really were, this was 20 years ago, these were the excesses of that sort of initial push, this war on drugs.
Absolutely. And in many cases, you saw instances over the years of, you know, the girlfriend who was a driver or who hung out with her boyfriend and really didn't even understand what the conspiracy or the deal was about. So in these cases, you know, this is a perfect example of somebody who was just caught up in a drug sentence like this, and he's one of them. What makes him so compelling as a character, I think, is the fact that this is a guy who was sentenced by a Republican-appointed judge, a Republican prosecutor, and there was a Republican president in the White House, all of whom were extremely interested in helping Clarence Aaron, who believed that his sentence was harsh, who believed that he had served enough time, and at 14 years, basically sought for him to be released from prison. The story we tell is how that didn't happen and why.
Yeah, and I think this, again, was the part that was shocking. So you've got all of these folks, including the prosecutor at the time of this clemency mm-hmm. plea, basically, or commutation plea, who says this is a perfect candidate for it. So why doesn't it happen?
Well, this is really the mystery at the heart of this story, which is that you have a pardons office, which is basically a gatekeeper inside the Justice Department. You know, the president's power to pardon is as old as the Constitution. The founding fathers fought over whether or not a president should have this kind of power.
Right.
And, you know, they really felt that the president had the right to right injustices,
yeah.
And to dispense mercy.
Yeah.
What we found is that huge segments of society are being left out mm-hmm. of that chance at presidential mercy without even the president knowing it. So when we went into the series, we were looking at, you know, is the president's power well served by this pardons office? Mm-hmm. In the case of Clarence Aaron, where you have, you know, every single box checked, you know, and in addition to all the support he's had, he's a model inmate. Mm-hmm. He's had just an extraordinary path in, you know, during incarceration. And still, he's a no. You know, the pardons office, as we found, you know, we can talk about the statistics, as you said, you know, President Obama has said no to thousands of people. In the last 4 years, the pardons office, 2 presidents, has recommended 7,000 no's, 7 a day, every working day.
Yeah, well, so this is, you know, sort of our last moment together, but so what can we do now? So, you know, part of the reason we wanted to highlight this, we've talked a lot about Trayvon Martin, but whatever justice or injustice comes in that case, Trayvon Martin is gone. His life is over. Clarence Aaron's is not. So is there anything that any viewer or can do that makes a difference in Clarence Aaron's case?
Well, I think the family has done a lot to try and create petitions online for him. And I think, again, he's a symbol because there are a lot of people just like him who want a fair shot. All they want is a fair shot. Mm-hmm. You know, we found that white applicants were four times as likely to be pardoned than people of color. And that's not the way that system is set up to be.
Yeah. We appreciate so much you coming in and taking the time. We are going to keep our eyes on this case. Thank you for your amazing reporting here.
Thank you, Melissa.
Coming up, I'm going to talk to